And we begin tonight with former Vice President Mike Pence weighing his response to a new subpoena from Special Counsel Jack Smith. That subpoena is related to the investigation into Donald Trump's failed attempts to stay in power after losing his bid for re-election in 2020, according to a source familiar with the matter. Pence is the highest level person in Trump's orbit to face a subpoena, and perhaps the single most important witness to what actually happened in the lead up to and on the day of January 6th, aside from Donald Trump himself. You must remember that Trump's entire plan to try to overturn the election and our democracy with it relied on his second-in-command's willingness to play along and not certify certain states' electoral votes. While Pence had spent 4 years looking like a bobblehead, offering that loving, obedient gaze to nearly everything Trump asked of him, what we've learned over the last 2 years is that the pressure campaign waged on Pence to go along with Trump's coup attempt turned out to be a bridge too far. Though Trump did at least think about it. I mean, we know that Pence sought the advice of former Vice President Dan Quayle over whether he could actually overturn the election if he had the legal authority to do it. According to Bob Woodward and Robert Costa in their book, Peril, Quayle told Pence, "Mike, you have no flexibility on this. None. Zero. Forget it. Put it away." "You don't know the position I'm in," Pence said. "I do know the position you're in. I also know what the law is. You listen to the parliamentarian. That's all you do. You have no power." Now, we know Pence himself has publicly shared how the mastermind behind this plot, John Eastman, didn't even fully buy into it himself, describing an Oval Office meeting between them and Trump on January 4th, claiming, quote, "I turned to the president, who was distracted, and said, 'Mr. President, did you hear that? Even your lawyer doesn't think I have the authority to return electoral votes.'" And we know that when the New York Times reported on Pence's response the next day, Trump put out a statement, not only calling it fake news, but claiming that he and Pence were in total agreement that Pence did indeed have the power to act. As we learned from the January 6th committee hearings, that was a surprise to Pence and his team.
"We were shocked and disappointed because whoever had written and put that statement out, it was categorically untrue."
We know the pressure only intensified in those final hours before Congress was to certify the votes. That morning, Trump and Pence had one final call before Pence headed off to the Capitol, and it was anything but civil.
"It was a different tone than I'd heard him take with the vice president before.
The word that she relayed to that the president called the vice president, I apologize for being impolite, but do you remember what she said her father called him?"
"The P word."
We know the pressure continued when Trump spoke at his rally on the Ellipse.
"All Vice President Pence has to do is send it back to the states to recertify, and we become president, and you are the happiest people. I just spoke to Mike. I said, 'Mike, that doesn't take courage. What takes courage is to do nothing. That takes courage.' And then we're stuck with a president who lost the election by a lot. Mike Pence is going to have to come through for us. And if he doesn't, that will be a sad day for our country, because you're sworn to uphold our Constitution."
And we know that adding to that ongoing pressure were the threats coming from Trump's own supporters that he unleashed on the Capitol.
"Bring out Pence! Bring out Pence! Bring out Pence! Bring out Pence! Bring out Pence!
And we know that even as Pence came within 40 feet of those same insurrectionists who wanted to hang him, he refused to leave the building, knowing that it would allow the certification to be stopped, at least temporarily.
"And I understood that the vice president had refused to get into the car. That the head of his Secret Service detail, Tim, had said, 'I assure you, we're not going to drive out of the building without your permission.' And the vice president had said something to the effect of, 'Tim, I know you, I trust you, but you're not the one behind the wheel.'"
And that brings us to what we don't know. What else was said between Pence and his former boss? What else did Pence witness as he participated in all of these meetings? That is apparently what Jack Smith is hoping to find out. The answers to those questions could have very serious legal and political implications for Trump. And we have to be careful here that we do not know if this brings us closer to an actual indictment of Trump, because it kind of feels like we've been down this road before. However, as former U.S. Attorney Joyce Vance points out, we could be getting to the very end of the process at the very least. And joining me now is Olivia Troy, former senior advisor to Vice President Mike Pence, and Nick Ackerman, former assistant special Watergate prosecutor and former assistant U.S. attorney for the Southern District of New York. Thank you both for being here. Olivia, I do want to start with you. I mean, Mike Pence is somebody who has said in the past that the January 6th committee was not entitled to his testimony, that he wasn't standing in the way of anyone else doing it, but they're not entitled to it. Do you expect him to try to fight this subpoena? Because he's also written a book. I mean, he's put a lot of this out there already. But what do you make of the subpoena as somebody who worked for him?
Yeah, hi, Joy. I think this subpoena is critical. I think it gives him some political talk cover, so to speak, especially as he eyes 2024, because I think he will run. And I think this is sort of, it paves the way for him to say, well, you know, legally, I have to come forward. I should comply. So I do kind of see a path for him to do that. But I will say this, just because he complies with it does not mean that he's going to be rather forthcoming in whatever he says. I think he keeps his cards very close to his chest. And I think it's going to take further compelling for him to divulge more information, depending on what it is that they're looking for.
And let me come to the table here with you, Nick, because Mike Pence, in some ways, I mean, in every way, is the potential victim here. But he also did go along with it to a certain extent. I mean, at one point, he's talking to Dan Quayle, according to this book, right. Peril, and he says, well, you know, there's some stuff out here in Arizona. And, you know, the response from Quayle is, man, I live in Arizona. There's nothing out here. So he was entertaining going along with it, which implies that he knew something about the plot.
Oh, I think the whole plot was all geared towards Mike Pence. I mean, the fake electors, that was all geared towards what would be given to Mike Pence. The business about putting in a puppet attorney general that would sign a letter that would go to the legislature in Arizona saying that the election was rigged, and Georgia saying it was rigged. Everything that Donald Trump did was all geared at one point to the idea that Mike Pence would actually get up there and send those votes back to the states because of a finding that there was fraud in the election, all of which was false.
Right.
So he is a critical witness, and there is no way under the sun that any prosecutor in good conscience could either decide to indict or decide not to indict unless he first questions Mike Pence extremely thoroughly in a grand jury. He's got to take him through the entire time period, all of the conversations in minute detail. There's no hiding behind executive privilege here. I mean, that issue does not apply. The Supreme Court dealt with that in 1974 in Watergate. The government is entitled in a criminal investigation to every man's evidence, and that certainly includes Mike Pence. And I think what you're going to see is he's going to go into that grand jury, and he's going to be there for a long time.
And, you know, Olivia, what do you expect him to do? I mean, knowing him and having worked for him, he wants to run for president. He still wants the support of the Republican base, much of which is still very tied to Donald Trump. But he also is somebody who Donald Trump completely turned on January 6th. And we don't know if it was before or just on January. I mean, he literally was posting threatening tweets about Mike Pence. That Cassidy Hutchinson and others testified put Mike Pence in even more danger because there was an armed mob already busting into the Capitol, and he still wouldn't stop. Is Mike Pence the type of person who will say, you know what, my loyalty is gone, I'm going to tell the whole truth and not risk anything for this man anymore?
Yeah, you know, that's a tough question because that is the mystery of Mike Pence. You know, I do think that he loves this country. I'll say that he'll exhibit that loyalty. He exhibited on January 6th. And so I think that there is a part of him where he believes his faith, and I think he will do the right thing for the country, especially in this moment. I think it's critical. Now, the other hand of it is he's also very politically calculated. I mean, I know that he has been wanting that presidency for a long time. And so, you know, as we watch him, I watch him walk this fine line where he sometimes dips his toe in the water and he calls Donald Trump out, but then he quickly retrieves. And so, you know, in a testimony like this, it's behind closed doors. Why not just set the record straight and be forthcoming about everything that happened and all of the pressure that was placed on you? And I also want to know, why didn't you want to get in that car?
Yeah.
Why were you so concerned about it, right? But I think for him, that base is not coming back to him. And I don't know how many times he needs to be told that. I don't know who is advising him.
Yeah.
I don't know what delusional dream he's having that these voters that he lost on January 6th are going to come back and vote for him. So why not pave a different way? And I think that is the problem, Mike Pence. He hasn't done that, even though he writes in his book, but even as he's apologetic, right? He continues to be a Trump apologist over and over again, regardless of the fact that he put his family at risk, regardless of the fact that he's now going to go head on probably into 2024 against someone that he knows is a madman. He's lived this firsthand. I've seen it firsthand. But yet he still refuses to separate himself because I think he knows that that's where the Republican Party is.
Yeah.
And he needs them. He needs that base.
Well, and, you know, the thing about grand juries is that they don't care. And Nick Ackerman, if you, right, if you had him, you know, for, as you said, hours and hours and hours, what would you want to ask him? I mean, myself personally, I would also want to know what those Secret Service agents were saying. Did you trust those Secret Service agents? Because this could be about Donald Trump, but it could also be about some of them. What would you want to know?
Oh, I think we'd
Yeah, I would want to know.
Oh, I'm sorry. Nick first.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Go ahead, sorry.
Well, yeah, I think we'd want to know exactly what his suspicion was based on. I mean, why did he think they were trying to whisk him out of the Capitol so quickly? Was it one of the people that was close to Donald Trump that was in charge of doing that? Did somebody say something to him? I mean, I'm sure he knew that part of this whole plot was to stop that vote, stop the Congress from considering the electoral count. And that one way to do it was to get him off premises, get him out of the Capitol.